I remember when I talked about this team as one of my first sports bets. The Arizona Coyotes were terrible. They were at the bottom of the league, as usual, and were undergoing another round of perpetual rebuilding. But this time was different. Arizona underwent a conversion, and it was in the form of an analytical altar. John Chayka was one of the budding minds in the newfound scene of hockey analytics, and hopes were high for the Coyotes. Years of ineptitude and ownership turmoils aside, the Coyotes were turning a new leaf. Seriously, there's nowhere to go but up. How can this honestly get any worse? Yeah, you've learned absolutely nothing. So the Coyotes. Maybe Pierre Dorion needs to license out his famous quote, since all they can say about them is that they are a team. They run around in circles for the last 4 years. And it's not only led them to the same situation they were in, but now it's tethered down to quicksand. A team wrought by years of managerial mistakes will have to dig through more years of managerial mistakes. I know what you're thinking. What the hell happened this time? Quite a bit, but the main issue here is Analytic Wonderboy himself. You've heard the story too many times. Hotshot startup executive promises the world to investors, but is either too inexperienced, unskilled, and/or arrogant to execute on the vision. The company goes tits up in a few years, they produce nothing but smoke and mirrors, and people are out billions of dollars. That executive is Chayka, hockey's version of a snake oil salesman. Despite his past experience in hockey analytics, if you actually look at the moves he's made as GM of the Coyotes, they have nothing to do with any sort of analytics. The basic gist of analytics is to use data to find undervalued commodities and sign them at value to have peak efficiency as a team on the ice. To discover things that can't be seen with the eye. His early moves seem to be veering in this direction. Bringing in Alex Goligoski, trading for Nicholas Hjalmarsson, and acquiring futures for eating dead contracts. Not bad for early moves, but the big acquisition at the time was trading for Derek Stepan and Antti Raanta. Stepan was owed big money, but would fill a needed hole on the second line. Antti Raanta, a pure analytics move. Undervalued thanks to being a backup to King Henrik. Trading a first in Tony DeAngelo is steep, but worth it. At least for one part. Raanta has been excellent for the Yotes, and is still useful for the team despite being usurped from the top goaltending role. Stepan? He regressed. Hard. Probably just bad luck, let's move on. As time passed, he would get bolder and bolder with his moves. One of the big ones was moving on from Max Domi. He was struggling immensely and needed a change of scenery. You know who else did? Alex Galchenyuk, the famed whipping boy of the Canadiens. A one-for-one deal commenced. Here's the issue. Banking on reclamation projects and hoping they return to form are not analytical moves. That's based on gut feelings and projection, once again defies database beliefs. It blew up spectacularly in Arizona's face. Max Domi returned to form and had a career season in Montreal. Galchenyuk, he became the Sam Bradford of hockey. One of these days he'll fulfill his potential. You'll see, he just needs more time. And with that, someone else would take a chance on him as Chayka doubles down. Phil Kessel is the analytical equivalent of a donut. He puts up goals and points, but he's an empty calorie scorer. He's useless in two of the three zones, he requires a shit ton of power play time, and he goes through long stretches where he's invisible on the ice. The base numbers look good, but they're hollow. John Chayka did not acquire Kessel because of analytics. He acquired him because he's buddies with Rick Tocchet. It doesn't take a genius to say that this move went against every damn rule in the book. Not to mention they added one of their better prospects in return for him. Take a guess as to what happened. He was completely invisible on the ice last year. He didn't even put up points, he just took up space. But what if I were to tell you that wasn't all he did? Chayka's biggest downfall was in his young prospect pool. In moves more fitting of Sahara Las Vegas, he gambled on player development and potential of four of these players. For a team that's been notorious for bad player development. Fuck the bridge deals, just throw big contracts at them. This is a big no-no in analytics. Analytics does not care for the idea of a good player. They just want good players who can perform at that level now. Throwing over $7 million per year for 8 years at Clayton Keller for 1 year isn't analytics. That's paying for the idea of a franchise center. Lo and behold, since the contract was signed, Keller stalled out. He isn't even playing center on the Coyotes these days. The contract looks terrible. Nick Schmaltz and Christian Dvorak were extended long-term on the idea that they would become top-flight forwards. Not what they were at the time of signing. Speaking of Schmaltz, Dylan Strome was incredibly underwhelming in Arizona, yet immediately panned out when he was traded to Chicago. This seems to be a trend. The only one of these extensions that panned out was Jacob Chychrun, and that's because he's developed properly. More shocking than Chayka's actions. The only one worth extending to a huge deal at the time of signing was Oliver Ekman-Larsson, mostly due to his performance being worth it. These kind of defensemen don't grow on trees, and he was rewarded for it. as analytics justifies. So I may be saying this with some hesitation. There's a good reason for it. OEL, since the time pen was put to paper, has suffered massive, massive, massive regression. Even for not being 30, it looks to be one of the worst contracts in hockey at this time. It's gotten so bad that Arizona tried to offload him this offseason. But they demanded too much and nobody bit. Even for Vancouver or Boston, they don't want to risk a huge cap hit on the idea of a top-pairing defenseman. There are cheaper and arguably better options on the open market. Which leads to the most damning indictment of Chayka's tenure as a so-called analytical guru. They're slammed up against the salary cap. A team that is in the middle of a rebuild and was floating near the cap floor a few years ago should not be locked into this kind of borderline cap hell. Even worse, the Coyotes have trouble scoring goals and have to rely on goaltending playing balls out to win games. This isn't sustainable. This is the kind of shit you'd expect from Shirelli, not a proclaimed analytics guy. The previous season might fool you a bit since they won a playoff series for the first time in over 3,000 days. Darcy Kemper, a Chayka acquisition, played out of his fucking mind. They might re-sign their new acquisition in Taylor Hall, their biggest buy on the market in years. I'd share your optimism, but the team suffered a hard collapse deep into February, and the only reason they made the playoffs was due to a pandemic. They wouldn't have been here in a traditional season. Also, the moment they faced a team that didn't shit their pants, they got their intestines ripped out of both orifices. It's hollow like Jacob's lip service to analytics. The only way this could get worse is if he openly shamed the organization. Wouldn't you take a wild guess as to what happened? He needs that analytical edge on his competition. So what if hosting your own draft prospect workouts are illegal by NHL bylaws? They need the data that the Combine cannot provide. Like having prospects work out in shorts and a t-shirt, and dyeing up their bodies. Peak analytics. Once Chayka got word that the league was investigating him for these shenanigans, he knew his time was up. He may have just been extended by the team, doesn't matter. He got the fuck out of Dodge before the hammer could fall on him. It's the mark of a grifter. And Chayka played it to perfection. Arizona was punished hard, losing a second round pick in 2020 and their first in 2021. They had traded their first in 2020 for Taylor Hall, and their third that year for Carl Soderberg. I reckon analytics didn't like this outcome either. But at least the ownership situation is solid for once. Alex Morello was openly vetted by Bettman as a stable cornerstone of the franchise. Even better, it makes inroads with the Latino community, so new paths to fandom are open. What happened here? Nothing much, just a pandemic that fucked over a good few industries. Bad luck for Morello, a good chunk of his money and revenue is based in casinos. Guess what's taken a beating since COVID? Casinos. Vegas has had some stiff restrictions as well, so it's a lot like being shanked and gutted in a public display. It affected the Coyotes. Throughout their time in the bubble, there were grumblings of delays in payment of per diems and bonuses to players. Regardless of circumstance, it's a terrible look. And it might not get any better until the country fully reopens and people go out in droves again. Now, the only way this could get worse is if they draft a literal piece of shit with their first pick in the draft. I'll give you a few moments to guess as to what happened. Mitchell Miller isn't just any plain old piece of shit. He's a guy who physically and psychologically tormented a black disabled kid for years. When you are summoned to juvenile court for said dehumanization, all pity is off the table. The dude hasn't even shown remorse for his actions. And he had been taken off more than a few teams' draft boards as a result. The Coyotes still drafted him. Once the story took off, they would try to say they didn't know and they were in turmoil because Chayka fucked off and they were looking for a GM. Bullshit, it was known from the beginning. Miller apologized to every NHL team before the Combine and interviews took place. So thanks to the predictable backlash, make that four draft picks pissed away by Arizona in 2020. I see they put as much lip service into progressivism as they do analytics. As for Soderberg and Hall, they didn't have the cap space to bring them back. They're gone. Just the same old song and dance these days. With these past few years, the Arizona Coyotes have not only disgraced themselves this time around, they've disgraced an entire league. Their actions have not only given a black eye to the sport, but they've gone against every single thing they were said to be a proponent of. Analytics, progressivism, dignity. John Chayka's tenure was merely one of showmanship and sweet lies that tasted good on the ears. And his actions locked the team into being a fringe playoff contender with significant damage to fix. Now, if Bill Armstrong can do it or not is to be determined. He somehow got Ottawa to part with a second-round pick for rapidly declining Derek Stepan, so early signs seem positive. But the same question remains. Can this team survive in Phoenix? They're still doing a year-to-year lease, and elements out of their control may jeopardize the plan. It's awfully convenient of them being moved to the Central Division when they've been linked to Houston in the past, and technically still are. I just wonder when the NHL will actually pull the plug on this disaster in the desert. At this point, I'll just breathe a sigh of relief to it being over. As you can see, Arizona's future is in flux. They're locked into a rough situation, and the threat of moving the team has remained as active as ever. You know what they need? Security. Especially when it comes to data and information protecting. They need to free themselves for the long term. And it can be done thanks to the sponsor of today's video, ExpressVPN. Their world-class protection and data encrypting technology can also help you in a variety of ways. Recently, an article in the LA Times has come out discussing a new phenomenon in streaming called churn. It's when you view the entirety of a program a service has to offer, then cancel the subscription to look for something else. But what if I were to say there was a way around this? To discover new programming by simply making a few clicks. ExpressVPN can do that. For services like Netflix, they offer different shows in different countries. What's offered in the UK and Canada is different than the US. For me, it's as easy as just a few clicks and the speed of the VPN does the rest. It not only offers more to the customer, but potentially avoids the infamous churn. And you can even get 3 months of world-class protection free by going to expressvpn.com/utree. The Coyotes may not be able to get it in their current situation, but you can. Remember the name ExpressVPN. It's honestly necessary these days.
Outlet finds Kadri. Kadri with a couple of tallies already today in the first period. Score! JT Comfer makes it 7-1.